my take on sharing economy is mainly from the academic point of view. So I guess based on my personal opinion is that there is some difference in terms of what we thought sharing economy is and what is actually happening today. I guess one of the fundamental principles to be classified, any businesses or operation to be classified as a sharing economy, is that we are essentially trying to make use of some unused resources or capability and try to generate some additional or extra revenue stream. That has been the principle in terms of academic research and academic work if you trace back like 2 decades ago. But what happened doesn't really matter, because I guess in practice, what is important is that we are actually creating value and benefit for society. So what we are seeing today in the market is essentially companies that are actually investing quite heavily in building up capabilities. So just now, Airbnb is being mentioned. So Airbnb is actually one of the pioneers we consider in terms of implementing sharing economy. However, if you look at like our not doing so well bike sharing companies, they're essentially investing very, very heavily to create this extra capability. And essentially, they are marketing it pretty much like a traditional service. So what is happening these days in terms of academic understanding and research is that innovation turns out to be still a core competence in survival of any companies who try to actually do well, or survivability in terms of maintaining survivability in the sharing economy. It is necessary, okay, and vital to have some innovation. And typically it's technology driven. And these days to a large extent is actually data centric. So this become the very important angles for any new businesses moving forward who would like to actually explore some new opportunity in sharing economy.
My main business is self-storage. So basically what we do is we will buy a building, divide it up into storerooms. People who have too much stuff in their house or small and medium-sized businesses can keep their stuff in there. So in markets like Singapore where space is scarce, it's a good, I guess, option for people who have more stuff than space. So our background is working with big institutional investors. In a sense, it's the opposite of sharing economy, because you're trying to make money from scarcity, in which case scarce space, whereas the sharing economy is trying to make money from everything that's out there. So a few years ago, I was thinking, I was a bit fed up with institutional investors. I was thinking, how do I get away from these guys? And I had used Airbnb for a family holiday, and I thought, that's an interesting business model. And then slowly clunking away. But actually, you could take the Airbnb model, instead of putting people, you could put people's stuff. In a market like Singapore, where the government is not so fond of the Airbnb model, I'm sure there must be plenty of people who have spare room in their house, but can't put people in there. What about stuff? I mean, stuff is less controversial. You don't have strange sort of foreign-looking types wandering around the neighborhood. And so from there came this business called Space Next Door, which, like its name, you look for space near where people are living or near where they need the space, and then we match them up. So it's like a two-sided marketplace, like Airbnb. We match them up with somebody who has the space. So we spent a year and a half developing the idea, and now this year we're actually launching it. Actually, I'm very optimistic about the potential for the business. We're at that scary point now, though, where we spent all our money, and now we need to earn money. But I think in terms of sharing economy, it fits perfectly, because you have people with excess space, you have people who don't have enough space, and we just provide the mechanism to match people up.
A hardcore army guy, worked, left the army in 2004, worked in corporate real estate for companies across Asia Pacific, and then a few years ago came across, I was deploying a lot of communications, video conferencing across different companies, and I was also thinking about how can we actually empower everybody to communicate without the dependency on the existing Microsofts, telcos, Ciscos, and so on and so forth. And with that as a premise, co-founded Yuwee, which essentially leveraged the power of the internet, the power of the increasing power of the browsers, which pretty much all of us kind of use, and then hooked in of how could I actually help mama papa shops or small businesses or bigger businesses enable to in being able to completely control communication. Everybody's been talking about communication, but nobody's quantifying communication. You talk about, yes, you know, we talk about AI, artificial intelligence, Alexa, and so on and so forth. Oh, that's great. Those fantastic. Jazz rolling out 5G in Singapore pretty shortly. That's going to help Amazon and the likes for faster computation. But what about that last mile? Who's going to talk? It's somebody talking to somebody, be it an AI or be it a bot or be it a human being. And how can we make that enterprise control the communication and benefit from it rather than other companies like Facebook's on Google and other social media to benefit? So with that, I spent about 2 years building this platform. Again, same as you, burnt all my cash up in building a platform. And we've just launched this month. We're signing up the first few clients, and I'll be more than happy to share more as we go along the discussion of how do I think that we actually contribute to the sharing economy. You know, for me, Mike is a sharing economy, is a business that's filling up some excess and some paucity. And how can people like me actually add value to them? We've discussed about Airbnb, and three major points that the Prof brought about was marketing, technology platform, which cost money, and communication at the end of the day. So how do I enable, bridge that, and make communication, I would say, cheaper by about 50 to 60% for these people so that everybody can now become communicable?
The business behind the sharing economy, not necessarily businesses that are actively engaged in the sharing economy directly, but it's trying to understand what it takes to start up something like this, other than guts and some cash, and the willingness to burn that money. Why is there this great desire to rush in and invest in a business and in an environment that is virtually quite unknown? Because the whole startup scene is new, but there's so much money coming in. I mean, if you look at it in 2014, it was valued at $14 billion. And by 2025, which is not that far away, it's going to be $335 billion business. And is that money being generated by active business, or is it from investment?
I don't have a crystal ball, so I don't have a definite answer. But based on my understanding is that it is pretty much hype-driven. Well, it is an in thing in that. But there's actually some logic underlying this hype that we have. If we look at the general consumer behavior across the last decade, we can see some fundamental changes. We are talking about Generation X, Generation Y, and the Millennium, for example. Their preferences, their attitude, and the way that they actually engage psychology in terms of making consumption decisions are fundamentally different. They prefer something which might not be able to be offered by traditional businesses. And this actually opened up a great opportunity for any companies who would like to jump in. And sharing economy, interestingly, offer or address some of these gaps. So for example, if you look at Airbnb, in a way it might be, from a price perspective, it is more economical, it is very competitive compared to five-star hotel. But if you look at young travelers, they might actually prefer a vacation which is more personal, more customized, and this might not be able to be offered by the traditional hotel line. So this is unfortunate. And we can also see that the incumbents, for example, just take hotel for example, they are unable to actually turn around very rapidly to actually make use of this new demand. We also observe a very similar phenomenon in the transportation industry. You look at taxi, our local companies try very, very hard to innovate, but I basically get very pissed off when I try to sign up their app and try to, you know, do their payment facilities. Where else, if you look at new entrants like Grab and Uber, the way that they actually facilitate the entire sign-up process and the entire user or customer experience is so much better. All right. So I think this actually can be one of the main reasons why it actually is so attractive to new investments.
Is it also because people are getting a bit bored with, investors are getting a bit bored with what's available out there? So technology has enabled a whole new area to open up and for them to put their money into. Yeah.
from my point of view, I think it's a very simple economic answer because, as an example, say with $10 million, I can buy a building. Well, I can buy half a building and need UOB to come and lend me the rest of it. I can buy one building, so I can dominate Padok or Totak or somewhere. Whereas with $10 million in a tech business, you can scale up. One, you use the technology to scale up, and two, by using other people's infrastructure, in our case property, but with Grab it's cars or Uber it's cars. So you take $10 million, you can go so much faster, so much further than my core business, which is you buy a property, then you buy another property, and then you buy another property. So I think one of the things investors are looking at is like speed. If the business is going to fail, it's going to fail fast. If it's going to succeed, it's going to succeed fast. And so these guys who are driven by IRR numbers, like the return you get in 3, 4, 5 years, that speed's important for them.
Okay. So I also, my perspective on this is maybe a bit more different. Is what I see, a 335 billion is actually the capability. I sharing economy has been there since ages for me. It's been there, you know, since I was growing up. Somebody's got a bed and breakfast going in. Somebody's got a paying guest coming in at home. It's been there since ages. It's how we, it's a barter system of sorts. And what I've seen is, again, these things have come and gone. It's primarily, have you found the financial viability to have the sharing economy running? Which to me, in my limited wisdom, has not been the case so far, because none of these businesses are generating huge amounts of profits or revenues. It's all about money being invested and reinvested on a premise that one fine day you'll be able to press the golden buzzer that we see in, you know, somebody's got talent kind of stuff. It is, to be very honest. Any example, Amazon, no profits, Uber, no profits, Grab, same, Gojek, maybe different because they are pretty much very diversified in what they do in Indonesia. But at the end of the day, again, with the investors' money is being burnt in marketing, in creating awareness, and purely technological platforms. So it's basically being used for research and development of platforms. Yep. That can manage to reach these places. And that's my take on it. So I don't see it as a value of business. I see the potential capability. You know, for example, Singapore's got, say, 5 million vacant rooms today. And if somebody can monetize on it, you're sharing. You're actually, as opposed to a traditional business, I would say, why did the Hiltons take, say, 93 years to build, and what Airbnb built in 3 years was because you are sharing with the end guy. But what is the platform on which you're sharing? That's where the consumption is taking place, and that's what's not making money. So do you think it's a scalable model? Yes, as long as there's unaccounted for money being pumped in, I think it's going to be happening. But for sharing economy like businesses like you, Mike, I think you've got to think of becoming more self-sustainable without all these other ancillary infrastructures that come in, so that you know that you've got a foreseeable future, that you are not dependent upon just burning cash from investors and so on and so forth.